About 2 weeks ago, Timothy did a great video on how to get started with transcribing and ear training with 3 very actionable exercises. I liked all the exercises and I really dig them, but there was just one major problem for me. This would not really have helped me when I was starting out with ear training, and even not really today, because I have to confess one thing. I really cannot sing. I am really the worst singer you can imagine. My sound of voice is terrible. I can't intonate. So reviewing my own process from the start, all that great singing advice for ear training wouldn't have helped me. Although when you search on YouTube, it seems to be the only way to get there. Let me give you a bit of my background. I had the most singing guidance and lessons for a non-singer you ever can imagine. When I started here in Belgium at the age 7 for music on the government music school, you have 3 hours each week dedicated to solfège and singing that solfège. Then I went to a special high school with a focus on music, which is a preparatory school for conservatory. There I had 4 years of personal guidance from a real vocal teacher. Again, lessons solfège with lots of singing, including separate intonation exercises, oh boy, and even atonal intonation exercises that were excruciating for both the teacher and me. And there was also that school choir. Then after that I went to the conservatory and there was another 4 years of ear training with a focus on intonation with singing. The worst thing of all of it maybe was even that as the years passed by from early childhood to older, my ears did get better and better, so I could identify even more how bad I was at singing. So how then exactly did I end up transcribing more than 100 solos for this channel and really enjoy it, and having done also tons of lead sheets and arrangements for other people? I think the singing is not exclusive at all for ear training, so let me give you 5 actionable steps for all those of you who also can sing like me. The first tip is upgrade your music reading skills first. If you want to notate music onto paper, it makes sense to do also the opposite first, being able to read the notes and the rhythms very well from sheet music. Like I just said before, I had a lot of classes on sight reading and just reading in general, and I also studied classical saxophone. So this really enhanced my ability to simulate the rhythm music in my head. When you practice your reading skills, you will also stimulate the opposite way to reconstruct the lines when transcribing by ear. This is basically called pattern recognition. That's why I really think you should spend time on reading every time you take up your instrument to practice. Don't make too much out of it, literally any rhythm music will do, but try here and there to increase the complexity to really stimulate that brain of yours. Tip 2. Learn your scales. Tons of melodies are stepwise, diatonically or chromatic. Most of them fit into a scale or a part of a scale. So when you learn your scales on your instrument, really try to absorb them rather than just only learning the mechanics. When you hear, for example, a diatonic major scale, most of us, beginners included, easily recognize that sound. The next steps in building degree of difficulty would be the chromatic scale and the pentatonic scale. Next, the different minor scales, Aeolian, harmonic, melodic, and Dorian. And then the advanced ones would be something like the whole tone scale and the half whole tone scale, or the octatonic scale. If you've done all that, well, then you have done already half of the work involved in melodic pattern recognition. The next one is know thy options. This idea is building on the last one. It means that when transcribing melodies or solos, if you ask yourself the right questions, you can narrow it down to yes or no questions or A, B questions. Starting with just very basic, is the next note higher or lower? Then, is it a small step or a big step? Imagine for a moment that the answer to that question would be a small step. Then the next question would be, is it a very small step, like in chromatic, or rather diatonic? If it's diatonic, does it sound inside or outside the context or chords that are in this music? If the answer to that first question was a big step, is it then really big or just a medium big step? If it was a medium big step, then we would enter the arpeggio possibilities. Certainly when transcribing jazz and even more so when transcribing bebop. If none of these mentioned already, then it means it's a rather big step. So it can be one of the open intervals, like a fourth or a fifth. I will make separate videos for that in the near future, as that is a very big topic, but you get the idea. So before we move to the next steps, a very important side note. Maybe it's even the main note of this video. Listen to what you play and how it sounds. So many people don't actually listen to the notes they're playing on their instrument because they are already occupied by simulating the notes that they are going to play next. When practicing the scales, for example, do it so slow so you can give your mind the opportunity to focus on the sound in general instead of only the mechanics of your instrument. Next, start playing some drums. My brother Gary is a pretty damn good drummer, if I can say so. So there has always been a drum or even multiple drums in my environment. Learning some basic grooves and paradiddles with accents helps a big deal in the rhythmic pattern recognition part of transcribing. I do really think there seems to be an overfocus on melodic practicing for the melodic instruments. We put most of the time putting the notes in the right order with the right sound, and mostly not too much on your rhythmic perfection. That's why I really love to study Latin musicians like Paquito de Rivera. Those Cubans are so well rhythmically trained that they know how to use rhythm and flow in between the rhythmic lines and really still keep a very solid inner groove. Some sticks and a practice pad will do if you have no access to a drums, and it will enhance your rhythmic ability and your playing in general. This is still mainly undiscovered ground for many Western musicians that only play melodic instruments. Timothy actually made already a very comprehensive video on how to start as a non-drummer. And the last tip is insert the chord structure before you start transcribing. If you want to transcribe something you have already a lead sheet of, great, put them already into a layout before you start with the melody. However, make sure that you always check those chords, even when you bought an official lead sheet. My experience with those kind of lead sheets is that there are always some kind of places where I kindly disagree. But if you don't have a lead sheet with already the chords of the tune you want to transcribe, start with transcribing that chord progression and put those chords above the bars, divide them already into 4 bars per line. If you aren't comfortable with transcribing chords yet, make sure to hit that subscribe button because that's a big topic and there are videos coming in the near future to help you with all that. So now you might think, what's the use of that? Well, it gives you much more notion of which tone material the line or the melody you want to transcribe can be situated in. It will help with that very important yes or no question, does it sound inside or outside the chord? Whatever the answer to that question, you can almost eliminate half of the 12 options you have to decide upon. So, bottom line, if you cannot sing, which basically means you cannot control those vocal cords you have, don't sing. Of course, you can try to get better at it, but it also can really hold you back from improving your ears. To be honest, once in a while, certainly when I hear a pitch very bad and soft in the mix, I will sometimes try to catch it with my voice and mostly succeed by now. And when I succeed, it really does help to identify the note. I'm also surely not claiming it doesn't help. But I think you should try to recognize when your voice is standing in the way rather than help your ear. I also believe this advice really can help those who can sing. But singing is not the only process used with identifying pitches. So did you also have horrible experiences when being coached for ear training? Or if you can sing, does this extra information help? I really absolutely hope so. And let me know surely in the comment section below. That's all for now, and I'm Jorge Reyners from Sharp 11 Music, and see you next time.